You've probably heard this word a lot lately.
PCR testing.
PCR test.
PCR test.
PCR is more than just a test for infectious diseases. It literally transforms science as we know it.
Oh, it's critical. PCR is in that realm as far as one of the most revolutionary technologies that we've had.
But for its importance, not many people know what it is. So today, I'm going to go over how PCR works and how its discovery involved an eccentric scientist, LSD, and a crusty bacteria on the side of a hot spring. Today, I'm at the University of Southern California, where my friend is going to show me how his lab runs PCR. This is a PCR machine, also known as a thermocycler. It has the ability to make billions of copies of a target DNA sequence in a matter of hours. Its invention revolutionized genetics, microbiology, forensics, food and drugs, anything that involved DNA.
And that really allows scientists to start analyzing and manipulate DNA. Instead of trying to get very pure, high quantities of raw DNA samples, you can have lower quality, less of it, but then amplify it to a high amount. PCR is so powerful that you can actually split microbiology to pre-PCR era and post-PCR era.
Breakthroughs in the structure of DNA sent the science world into a frenzy. Researchers knew that the applications for unlocking DNA were limitless. Yet, there was one problem they couldn't quite seem to escape, the problem of quantity.
DNA was always going to be the least easily obtained of the things that were involved in a DNA type experiment. That was going to be the hardest one.
Imagine you're in a crime scene in the 70s and the killer left a drop of blood on the floor. That's great, right?
Wrong.
The problem is there isn't enough DNA in this drop of blood to analyze. If you can amplify it, you can analyze it. In the early days, technology to amplify DNA was limited, but one popular technique was bacterial cloning.
Before it can be sequenced, DNA has to be extracted from cells and grown up in bacterial colonies.
If you put DNA into bacteria, the bacteria will think the DNA is its own. And as the bacteria replicates, so will the DNA. Do this thousands of times, kill the bacteria, isolate the DNA, and bada bing, bada boom, you have thousands of copies. There were a few problems with this technique. One is it was error prone, and two is it took time.
We had just finished cloning a gene at Cetus that took 40 people 6 months.
Obviously, this is not a sustainable practice. What the science world needed was an accurate way to make millions to billions of copies of DNA in a short amount of time. Which brings us to this man.
Dr. Carey Mullis.
Carey Mullis.
Dr. Carey Mullis, the world-renowned inventor of polymerase chain reaction, winner of the 1993 Nobel Prize for Chemistry.
In 1983, Dr. Carey Mullis discovered polymerase chain reaction, better known as PCR, in an unlikely place.
I thought of it while I was driving my car, which is always a good thing to do when you're thinking about new things.
Carey Mullis lived in Northern California at the time, and he would drive 3 hours from Berkeley to Mendocino every weekend. And in one particular drive, PCR came to him like a bolt of lightning, with the help of one substance.
As LSD.
Legend has it, Carey was on LSD when he discovered PCR. He was so excited, he pulled over to the side of the road and wrote everything on the back of a receipt. Now, Carey was a huge proponent of LSD. He even went as far to say he never would have come up with PCR without it. But what I think amazed him and the world about PCR was how simple it actually was.
And that's a great thing about PCR. It's phenomenal how essential PCR is, but also how simple it is.
To fully understand how PCR works, we first have to understand DNA and DNA replication.
My name is Dr. Ryan Woltz. DNA holds all of the blueprints for how to make every single machinery and structure for your cells, such as all the different proteins. All the proteins, all they are just machines inside your cell.
DNA consists of a sugar backbone and a base. Specific combinations of these bases code for proteins. That's why DNA is often referred to as a blueprint. It literally holds the information on how to make proteins. DNA is so important, a copy of it has to end up in every cell. This brings us to... Okay, so we need three things to replicate DNA. We need proteins, primers, and bases. DNA is held together by hydrogen bonds. Proteins break the bonds and unzip the DNA to expose the bases. DNA primer comes in and attaches to the ends of the strand. Now think of DNA primer like paint primer. Paint primer helps paint stick. DNA primer helps a very important protein stick called DNA polymerase. No primer, no state. DNA polymerase is the workhorse of replication.
That's your main guy is DNA polymerase.
That's our homie right there.
That's our homie.
It chugs along the strand like a train, adding bases as it goes, eventually completing a new strand. And simply put, that's it. And now that brings us to... Now I'm going to teach you the first version of PCR. Amazingly, it works almost identical to DNA replication, with one huge difference and one glaring inefficiency. Let's go through the steps and see if you'll figure it out first.
Typical steps of PCR you can think of as denature, annealing, extension. You just keep repeating that how many cycles you want.
And usually we repeat it to about 20 to 30 cycles.
Denaturing essentially is having a high temperature, typically seeing 95, 98 degrees, something like that.
Now this was the biggest difference. Normal DNA replication uses proteins to break the hydrogen bonds between the bases, but PCR uses heat. 98 degrees Celsius is 2 degrees away from the boiling point of water. Needless to say, that's really hot.
And that breaks apart all your hydrogen bonds. And so your hydrogen bonds are gonna basically turn double-stranded DNA into single-stranded.
So once it becomes single-stranded DNA, then the small primers you add has the ability to come and bind. So that's where the annealing step comes. That happens at a lower temperature.
From 40 to 50 degrees Celsius.
And lastly, we have extension, where DNA polymerase comes in and extends the strands, adding new bases, just like DNA replication, until you finally have two new strands. If you repeat this process 30 times, you'll end up with a billion copies of DNA. And that's the first version of PCR. It's so simple, it's almost unbelievable.
Not a lot of people believed it right off.
Well, the reason they didn't believe this was because of the fantastic result of it.
This can't work. If it works, I'm in trouble.
If this works, what the hell am I going to do? Why do we need to clone DNA? In one afternoon, I can amplify it all up and do it without cloning it.
The brilliance of PCR is that it uses the same components cells and bacteria use to replicate its own DNA. But this also contributed to the problem. Did you figure it out?
Denaturing essentially is having a high temperature.
High temperature?
A high temperature is required to break apart the bonds between DNA. But it's so hot that it also breaks apart DNA polymerase, our homie.
That's our homie.
PCR is repeated for many cycles. So when it's heated back up to 98 degrees, DNA polymerase is cooked like an egg, rendering it useless. Scientists would have to add new DNA polymerase after every cycle, which is not only tedious, but extremely expensive. DNA polymerase ain't cheap. Carey knew in order to take PCR to the next level, he'd have to find a way to get around the heat problem. This brings us to our final puzzle piece. Let's go on a little field trip. I'm next to this hot spring in Yellowstone National Park, the birthplace of one of the greatest scientific discoveries of our lifetime, polymerase chain reaction. Yellowstone is world-renowned for its wildlife, geysers, and hot springs.
Oh my God, this is so blue.
But what we're looking for is living inside the hot spring. At the fringe of this hot spring, you're gonna find this red-orange crust-like mud. But with further inspection, you'll see that this mud is actually alive. This is made out of a bacteria called Thermus aquaticus. Thermus coming from the Greek word thermos, meaning heat, and aquaticus meaning water. So essentially it's a hot water bacteria. And this primarily feeds on the hydrogen sulfide being emitted from the hot spring itself. Thermus aquaticus is what we call a thermophile. Thermo being heat, phile meaning loving. So it's a heat-loving bacteria. What makes Thermus aquaticus, or TAC for short, so special is that it can survive temperatures upwards of 176 degrees Fahrenheit. So just for perspective, water boils at 212 degrees Fahrenheit, and jacuzzis hang around 105 degrees Fahrenheit. Now this is where Carey Mullis got his bright idea. Remember, all organisms have DNA, and all organisms need to replicate their DNA to reproduce or just to survive. So the question is, how does this organism, this bacteria, replicate its DNA in such high temperatures? He figured that the proteins responsible for DNA replication had to be heat resistant. And in the fall of 1985, they were able to isolate TAC's DNA polymerase, dubbing it TAC polymerase. But how does it do this? Let's take a look at your normal DNA polymerase. Now compare that to the heat resistant TAC polymerase. Look how much bigger it is. TAC has more hydrogen bonds, covalent bonds, salt bridges, and cross-link folding, all of which limits unraveling at high temperatures. This was the answer everyone was looking for, a polymerase resistant to heat. TAC polymerase can withstand temperatures close to boiling and remains active at 70 degrees Celsius. That's the temperature of a well-done steak. TAC quickly replaced DNA polymerase in labs around the world. Now researchers didn't have to add new polymerase after every cycle. And in 1993, 10 years after his discovery of PCR, Carey Mullis won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. And since then, technology for PCR has jumped leaps and bounds.
It is one of the best machines I have ever come across. This is a thermocycler.
Thermocyclers automated PCR. Now you didn't have to heat your solution by hand. RTQ PCR was invented to amplify single-stranded RNA, which is used for certain pandemic-y viruses. Genetic fragments from viruses can be amplified and analyzed to see if you're infected. PCR was woven into our society right under our noses. It was an instrumental tool for the Human Genome Project, a 13-year endeavor that sequenced all human genes. PCR finally allowed the medical field to identify genetic diseases.
I was the first lady to have the DNA test for cystic fibrosis. That test was done at 10 weeks and I had the result at 11 weeks.
It even helped with the advent of paternity tests.
You are the father!
In August of 2019, Carey Mullis died at the age of 74, leaving behind a legacy that some say is marred by controversy.
People will call you eccentric if you take a position that's different from the masses of the people, right? And I often do.
I'm not gonna get into detail in this video, but what I will say is that out-of-the-box thinkers are needed, especially in science. They're the people where an apple bonks them on the top of the head and they come up with gravity.
It's really important to do discovery research. The biggest leaps have been coming up with someone being like, you know what? I'm really interested in this guy. I really want to know what this thing is doing.
Is there a message you'd like to tell people as far as science?
Yeah, there should be more money allocated to high-risk, high-reward research. That's what I think. I feel like there's good ideas out there, but if you want new solutions, you can't come up with solutions using the same way of thinking that got you there in the first place. Right?
Imagine all the other discoveries that are hiding in the fringes of nature, or just even below our feet. Allergies was accidentally discovered using sea anemones. Alessandro Volta, the guy Volt is named after, based the first ever battery on electric eels. So if someone asks you why you should care about frog conservation or protecting lands, tell them it's because it could be hiding the next PCR. I'm the Backpacking Biologist, and thanks for watching. So I want to give a big thank you to my buddy Brandon Holt, who made the animations for the DNA polymerase and TAC polymerase. Check out his website here. I also want to give a huge thank you to my scientific buddies, Phil and Ryan. I went to college with them and they took a lot of time to record this video for me. So thank you so much. And in some exciting news, I just opened up a Patreon. So if you want to support the channel, I do all the editing, I film, I backpack, I do all that stuff all by myself, and I'm not even an editor. I had to teach myself how to edit. So that's why it actually takes a long time for me to produce these videos. Hopefully, eventually, I can afford an editor. But if you would like to support the channel, it would help so much with me producing these videos and me taking the time and the money to go out and actually film. So I appreciate you. Thank you for watching. Love you guys. Peace.